Right. So I would be talking about acute chemical injuries. So we know that these are true ocular emergencies, and out of all the ocular injuries that we encounter, 10 to 22% are chemical burns, and they affect the young male population more than the females, and 20% of these can lead to significant cosmetic and visual disability. So just going over the different alkali agents that we see, I will just like to highlight that lime is frequent, more frequent in our country. And although because it forms a particulate matter, the penetration is lesser, but it tends to get coagulated in the upper fornix, and therefore eversion of the upper lid is very important to look for residual lime particle when we are treating cases with lime injury. Now, amongst the acid, the most dangerous is the hydrofluoric acid, which can penetrate very easily. And there are different compounds that have been used as an antidote, like calcium gluconate, to take care of patients who have hydrofluoric acid burns. So this is one of the true ocular emergencies. And the dictum here is that treat first and examine later. All we need to do is do a quick examination to rule out open globe injury, and then proceed with copious irrigation with the cleanest fluid that we can easily access, is easily accessible to us. And like I mentioned before, double eversion when we are irrigating the eye is important to look for any residual particulate matter. If we have litmus paper strips with us, it helps to check the pH from the ocular surface. Now, the most common classification that we use here is the Duwa's classification, which is based on the extent of the limbal involvement as well as the bulbar conjunctival involvement. A few fallacies that we have in Duwa's classification, it does not talk about the scleral ischemia and the intraocular pressure, but it helps us in clinically assessing the severity of the chemical burn for us. So if you look at the major principles in management, first and foremost is re-establishment of a corneal epithelial surface, rigorous control of the inflammation that occurs in these eyes, and must not forget intraocular pressure that needs to be monitored. So let's look at a few cases now. This is a grade 1 chemical burn. We don't have any involvement of the limbus. There is no stain taken up in the limbus. And this is a grade 2 burn, and staining helps us in actually assessing the extent of the epithelial defect both on the conjunctiva as well as the cornea. And these can be managed usually with medical management alone. So the medical management essentially consists of topical steroids, which need to be frequent, and depending on the grade of the injury, we can decide how frequent topical steroids we need to instill initially. This helps in controlling inflammation, and cycloplegic eye drops for symptomatic relief, antibiotic eye drops as a prophylaxis against infection, and we can use lubricant eye drops as well as ascorbate to support the process of repair and promote epithelial healing. So if you look at this case of grade 1 chemical burn, this healed in the next 4 days just after medical management. Now this is a grade 3 burn. We can start initially with medical management, but we have to assess the healing and stain the surface and call the patient frequently for follow-ups, and they might require surgical management if it does not heal. This is a more severe variety of burn. This is a grade 4 chemical burn, and these cases usually require us to intervene surgically. And we know that amniotic membrane graft helps us in essentially promoting epithelial healing and also providing symptomatic relief. So here we'll just go over the amniotic membrane graft here. So what we need to do is cover the ocular surface and use fibrin glue on two different syringes, which makes it easier for us to apply the fibrin glue. And we deflect both the surface from the amniotic membrane graft and iron the glue out and secure it in position. We could use a suture on the side if we need and we feel that the amniotic membrane is not going to stay, or use a BCL on top. And these cases, especially if we have inferior signs, or if we have signs of exposure, if we have a large epithelial defect or inferior limbal ischemia or scleral ischemia, tarsography helps greatly in preventing the amount of exposure. And also, since the tarsal conjunctiva comes closer to the bulbar conjunctiva, it helps in vascularization and promotes epithelial healing. So these cases, the kind of tarsography that we need to do will again depend on the severity of the burn. So here we are doing a lateral paramedian tarsography, but some of these very severe burns might require a central tarsography to promote the healing. This is the same patient followed up after 8 months, and he subsequently developed a total limbal stem cell deficiency for which he underwent SLET. Now, here in this video, I would only like to highlight, this is a case of ocular surface burn, actually, thermal burn. And here we need to remove the necrotic tissue that we have here. So otherwise, this necrotic tissue is going to inhibit the healing. And we, in some of these cases, tenonplasty or advancement of the tenons actually helps in vascularization. So this is something that we must not forget. If there's necrotic tissue on the surface, that must be removed as well. And this was followed by an amniotic membrane graft and a complete tarsorrhaphy. Now, the technique of alloslit has been described by the SN group, which helps in grade 4 and above burns, and the epithelization is faster with alloslit as compared to an amniotic membrane graft alone. So in terms of how to deal with a large epithelial defect, if the defect is less than 50%, we can go ahead with amniotic membrane graft. And if it is non-healing, that we should consider an alloslit. And patients with severe burns or large corneal conjunctival, bulbar conjunctival defects, we could straight away go either for alloslit or mucosal grafts. Now, this is a recent paper by the LVP group which highlights the importance of ischemia and the role of tenonplasty. So here again, the idea is that if we have necrotic tissue that needs to be excised so that the vascularization can be promoted and the conjunctival epithelium grows over it. So this is one of the cases that they have demonstrated in this paper, where we can see that there is inferior scleral ischemia as well as limbal ischemia, and advancement of tenons greatly helps in vascularization. So the idea is that it prevents corneal melt and it promotes healing of the epithelial surface. But this is useful in severe grades of burns. So this is the dictum that has been proposed. So if we have specially delayed presentation more than 1 week with clear areas of ischemia, then if we have access to anterior segment OCT angiography, this will help us in assessing the amount of limbal ischemia, and tenonplasty would greatly help in assessing this and going ahead with the procedure. So to conclude, these are true ocular emergencies. Initially, for these cases, we need to start frequent topical steroids to take care of the inflammation. The things that we need to look out for are monitor the epithelial healing, the scleral ischemia, as well as the intraocular pressure. And the techniques that we have in our armamentarium, which we need to combine and choose for different cases, include amniotic membrane graft, alloslit, tenonplasty, and tarsorrhaphy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lal. Just for the Indian audience, when we talk about chuna particles, we have to differentiate. Would you like to talk about a couple of words about the difference between the edible chuna and the plaster chuna distemper? When we see chuna injuries, there are two forms which we see. The one is the chuna or the calcium hydroxide used for painting surfaces. That comes mostly in liquid form. Which is which one can irrigate away easily. But unfortunately, there is another form of chuna available, or calcium hydroxide, which is in paste form, which is edible form. And if that gets into the eye, the scenario is very different, because it actually stays like a depot in the eye and in the fornices. So when a patient talks to us that they got chuna in the eye, we need to differentiate whether it's edible chuna or whether, because they take it as the same, but the behavior is quite different.
And especially in the packets that it comes in, which can burst open and then
yes, so the packet generally, the funny thing, or the unfortunate thing, is that the people who actually use those things, they are aware of the dangers. So it generally happens to the bystanders or the attendants of someone. You ask someone to fetch that packet of chuna, and it's like a soft squeezy ball. And if I give it in your hands, you will also try to, you know, just squeeze it. And it bursts with the force, and it squirts it into the dominant eye of the patient and implants it in the fornix.
Unfortunately, most of these, what you call bystanders, are kids who have been sent by parents and uncles to the pawn shop.
Grandparents have sent those.